Okay, so thanks everyone for tuning in. Today we have Pascale Calabrese from Trieste, who's going to tell us about his work on subsystems distance in QFT. So Pascale, thank you very much and take it away.
Okay, so thank you for having me with this new system that I'm not very familiar. So for me, it's an experiment. Let's see how it goes. So during this hour or bit less, I will present you this recent work on subsystem trace distance in quantum field theory, as you asked me explicitly. And okay, so what all this is about? Okay, first of all, let's make very clear that in quantum mechanics, system may appear globally very different from what they are locally. Okay, so they can be locally very similar, but they can be very different altogether. There is a very old famous example about this, that is Anderson orthogonality catastrophe. This is an example that Anderson worked out in the 67, which tells that if you have a many body system and you just perturb locally with some impurity, the resulting ground state wave function actually will be orthogonal to the one you start with, independently of how small is the impurity and the coupling to the impurity. And okay, this is quite counterintuitive because the locally, the effect of this impurity, if it's weak, will be very small and the wave function will be indistinguishable from the one of the system without impurity. But what the impurity does is to create a phase shift that when it travels through the entire system, you will have a resulting wave function that is orthogonal. Okay, so this is an example of how things can be very different from locally and globally. And this is history now. A modern application of the same ideas is in the non-equilibrium dynamic of quantum system, isolated quantum system, in what usually goes as a quantum quench. And as you surely have heard, if you prepare some system in a given pure state, like it is depicted in this figure that you can see on the right of my slide, and then you let it evolve this pure system with an Hamiltonian that does not commute with the projector on the system, on the state itself, so there is a non-trivial time evolution. After very long time, you expect the system in some sense to be in some thermal state, okay, as it has been explicitly, for example, verified in this experiment. But obviously, this cannot happen globally, as it's written instead on the left side of my slide. The Gibbs state, the thermal E to the minus beta H, can never be equal to the projector on a pure state. One has a finite entropy, the other one is strictly zero entropy, so they can never match. But what can happen is that the two things are equal locally, in the sense that the reduced density matrix of the time-dependent state, as it's written on the bottom left of this slide, tends for a long time to the reduced density matrix of the thermal state. So all local observable in this case will be described by a thermal ensemble, even if globally the system is very different from a thermal ensemble. I hope it's okay for you if I continue this left, right, top and bottom, because I don't know how to point on this screen. So.
Yeah, that's fine.
Let's continue like that. Okay, now, this being said, that system can be very different than subsystem. One should understand, is it more worth to look at the system or the subsystem? Obviously, this will depend on the problem and on the idea, the things that you have in mind, like there are many instances in which we are physically motivated to look only at subsystem, actually, and there is no sense in making to look at the entire system, because, for example, in a many-body system, in given circumstances, it's possible to make a real measurement experiment only for local observable and not for global one. Okay, but even not only from practical reason, even from more theoretical reason, can be very informative to look at subsystem rather than the entire system, as should be very clear to the audience of this talk, probably. Phenomenon like the entanglement and information paradox, like, for example, in black hole, but in general in quantum mechanics, which are phenomena that are very much related, depends exactly on looking only at some part of the system and not to have access to the entire information or the entire wave function of the system. Okay, and nowadays, we know very well how to quantify entanglement. We know that entanglement of a subsystem provides fundamental information about the subsystem itself. But the question of this talk is to move a bit farther away and trying to build tools that are able not only to classify the what happened to the a given subsystem in one state, then what happened to the subsystem in the other state, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But we would like to have tools that are able to distinguish between subsystems in different states. So we have the same subsystem, one is in some state, once is in one state, another time is in another state, and we want some quantitative information about their difference. Okay, so what we want is a distance between reduced density metrics, basically. And distances between the reduced density metrics have been introduced in quantum information quite a lot. For example, in this green box that you see here, you can see the what are usually called Schatten-N norms, or simply N distances, as I will refer to the future, where the distance between two density metrics is nothing but the N norm of the difference between the two density metrics. Okay, normalized to 1 over 2 to 1 over n in such a way that the maximum distance is 1, and obviously the minimum is always 0. So I hope that this the notation inside the green box is clear to everyone.
I think that's
Is it? I can continue. So the distance is just the norm, the n norm of the difference of the two matrices, okay? But now, if you have a finite dimensional Hilbert space, all norms are equivalent. This is a very basic result of linear algebra. And they are equivalent in the sense they bound each other, as is written in the second equation of the slide, basically, that if you take, for example, the norm n, this can be bound by the norm n, both up and down, with two different constants. One is the inverse of the other, obviously. Okay, this is, I think, almost everyone is aware of this fact, and it's quite basic. So in a five-dimensional Hilbert space, it's not very important to discuss which norm we are using or which distance we are using. They, in the end, they will all provide the same order between density metrics. But as also is often studied in some advanced course of quantum field theory, norms are not any more equivalent when the dimension of the Hilbert space diverges, okay? And this is very important for us because we want to study quantum field theory, so we will work in infinite dimensional Hilbert spaces, and the various norms are different. They don't provide the same information about the system. And actually, to be precise, these bounds that here appear as C and M depends, if you remember your linear algebra course, on the dimension of the Hilbert space. If this bounds also depends on the dimension of the Hilbert space, what you have is that it will be difficult to compare different subsystems that have different dimensions. Like you have a subsystem of length L and a subsystem that have length 2L, these two subsystems live on different Hilbert space with different dimensions, which are exponentially different the dimension of the two Hilbert spaces. And you cannot compare norms with this strange factor bounding them, okay? Strange factor that depends on the dimension itself. Okay, so what one really needs to find out is if one of these norms is better than the other. And okay, it's, there is a huge literature, especially in quantum information theory, but it can, even in more classical fields, like in quantum field theory or in quantum mechanics, the trace norm, which is the D1 among the one in the green box, it's quite special. And it's quite special because of this inequality that appear at the end of the slide, that if you want to bound the expectation value of an operator, that in the end is what actually you measure, okay? If you want to bound the difference of the expectation value of an operator on one density matrix and on the other, this object will be bound by the one norm, okay? Without any strange factor, okay? Only the norm of the operator itself, that usually it's a finite number that you can put there. Okay, and instead, if you would bound in terms of the other norms, you will get this Hilbert space dimension factor, which in the end will just lead you to the trivial result that the difference between these two operators is smaller than infinity in the limit of infinite dimensional Hilbert space. Okay, so if you want to bound operator, the most natural object that you need to consider is the trace norm, which is the distance one among those in the green box.
Pascal?
Yes?
But what do you mean by reasonable local operators?
I mean that they themselves have a finite trace norm, because obviously you can end up in the crazy situation in which the operator itself is infinite dimensional. Okay, like if it's the product of all the local operators, so it's not really much local. Okay, in that case, obviously the trace norm will be useless because there will be this trace norm of one that is infinity, but okay.
Okay.
The operator for me is unreasonable, so I'm happy to just say so. Basically, by reasonable, I mean that they have a finite trace norm.
Okay, thanks.
If they have finite trace norm, any of the difference will be bound by the distance. And this is, we will be very happy with this, I think. Both in condensed matter, quantum field theory, probably in string theory as well. So in all the aspects we can see, this distance, I think it's a very important fact that this inequality holds. Okay? So, we need to get an handle on this D1. The problem, we were not the first one saying that we should look at D1. There are many papers about this. What everyone realized is that evaluating D1 is very difficult. Evaluating this one is very difficult because since it's its definition is given by the sum of eigenvalues of this difference of density matrix. The only way to access the sum of the difference of the absolute value of the eigenvalue is to know the eigenvalues themselves. But getting these eigenvalues, it's complicated because you not only, already in general, it's complicated to access the eigenvalue of one density matrix. But getting the eigenvalue of the difference is not related to the eigenvalue of the matrix itself, because the two matrices do not commute and the operation is even more complicated. Okay? So our contribution to the, our main contribution, that's what I'm going to tell, is to use replica to calculate this difference. So I will just show in this slide the main idea of the replica, which is our main contribution. And then I will slowly show some application to quantum field theory and conformal field theory, entering in some detail of calculation. But for the part of really the physical input that we gave is to have this idea of using replicas to get the trace norm. Okay, so our replica idea is to not try to compute the eigenvalues of this difference, that is impossible, but just try to compute trace of rho A minus sigma A to the N, as is written on the third line of this slide, okay? And for integer N, this object is just a sum of the product of many rows and sigmas, okay? That we know how to handle both in many body physics, in quantum field theory, and in conformal field theory, that will be the main subject of the rest of my talk, okay? There is some non-trivial combinatorics behind this, that's obviously, and obviously we work out these combinatorics, and by the way, I will not give too many details because it's just, it's not something that is easily transmissible on a talk. It's okay, one should sit and make the combinatorics, but I will try to transmit the main physical ideas and the main physical result, okay? But so from the trace of this difference to the N, and in this rest of the slide, the difference is just denoted by lambda, capital lambda, how we can get the trace norm. Okay, what is known in some fields, also in disorder system and in other fields, is that when you make trace of this matrix to even and odd power, they have a very different behavior when rewritten in terms of the absolute value. This is quite trivial. So if you have the even power, which is the first line, the sum of the eigenvalues to the even power is equal to the sum of the absolute value to the even power. Okay, that's trivial. Instead, the sum for the odd power, the sum of the eigenvalue to an odd power is equal to the sum of the positive eigenvalue of the absolute value to the odd power minus the sum of the negative eigenvalues to the same power, okay? So when rewritten in terms of the eigenvalue, the two of the absolute value of the eigenvalues, even powers and odd powers behave differently, okay? It's a very obvious statement, the one that I'm saying, but it's important. And in fact, if you are familiar with standard replica trick for the entanglement entropy, you know that since all the eigenvalues are positive, the two things are equivalent and there is no distinction. When you deal with objects that have positive and negative eigenvalues, there is this important difference. And by the way, a very similar trick has been already used by myself and others, and also applied by many other people to calculate what is called the negativity, but this is not the subject of this talk, so I will just not mention what has been done there. Now, it's clear that if I take the first line of this two, the one for even number, and I put what there is called NE, this power to an even number, and I put there one, I just recover the trace norm I was interested in, okay? Instead, if I put NO in the second line equal to one, I would just get something else that is not the trace norm. It's just the normal trace, okay? So if one knows analytically for all even and odd N, the trace of the power of this difference lambda, okay? And one is, after having built them, have to stare at them to see that the analytic continuation from even and odd are different. Actually, on the last line, I just realized there is a typo, is NO, not NE. Okay, but if you take the limit of the even sequence, as I was claiming just before, you get the trace norm, which we are interested in. If instead you get the limit of the odd sequence, like in the last slide, you get the trace of this difference itself, that in this very simple case, where it's just the difference of traces of two matrix, since they are both normalized, is just zero, so it's completely trivial result, okay? So the idea, the conclusion is that in this replica approach, the trace distance is obtained from the limit of the even sequence of the trace of the power of the difference of the matrix. Okay, so in what is written in this last equation that in this slide is encircled in this yellow green box. Okay, is it clear the procedure?
Do you want to understand this calculation in terms of an analytic continuation, in the sense that you calculate the trace for the even?
Yeah, you can. We calculate the trace for the even. In our very specific case, all the odd traces will be zero in the trivial analytic continuation. But in general, when you have matrices that have, this applies every time that you have matrices that have also negative eigenvalues. Actually, if they are non-real and they have faces, it becomes even more complicated instead of want to enter in that discussion now for the ID continuation. But if they are just real, if when they are all positive, it's just usual story. There is no trick, both even and odd give the same results. When some eigenvalues are negative, as in the present case, or where it's the case with the negativity, you have two different analytic continuations. Okay, one for even and one for odd. And the one we are interested that gives what we are interested in is the one from even one. Okay, is it clear the idea?
Yeah.
Please interrupt me in any moment if something is not clear. So, how we get this power? The trace of the difference to the power n, as it's written here, is just the sum to minus one to the number of sigma. Basically, what this absolute value of S is the number of sigma, and time the trace of a product of this rho and sigmas. Okay, this is just Newton binomial, but with matrices. Okay, it's a really trivial thing. So you just expand this power into many products and you start calculating, okay? Anticipating, just to give you an hint of what is going on and why these things become easy, is that in conformal field theory, each term in this sum is related to a partition function on a given N-sheeted Riemann surface, which can be written in terms of twist field as written in this equation in the middle of the fields, which we will see again later. And if you don't understand now, you will understand later. Okay, I want just to anticipate why we are able to deal with this object, okay? You can rewrite the trace in the first line as this sum, and then this sum, we know each term in the sum, we know how to calculate, okay? And in fact, these terms in the sum have been already considered in the literature when calculating the relative entropy, okay, in the replica approach. And I will review this approach that will be basically the same, obviously, the same trick applies to the relative entropy and to the distances, okay? So this, how to get this object was first worked out by Lashkari, then Sarosu Gajin, then even myself with my student Paola Ruggiero have been working on these relative entropies, there we learn how to calculate each term in this sum, okay? As I was anticipating even before, the combinatorics, which means summing all these terms, is not trivial, and also the analytic continuation is not always easy, but still, in some cases, we can handle them. In some cases, it's too complicated, and then, okay, we have formulas that not really we can handle. You will see what happened. Okay? But now, this finish more or less the presentation of the main ideas. Now, in the remaining half an hour, I want to really build up and give the details how to dirty the ends to make some calculation and go back to the calculation. So do you have some question on this more idea part, okay, now how things are done? So if I pass the message of this first part, I'm already very happy because this is all the new concept, let's say. Then the rest is technicality and making calculation, which are fundamental, difficult, but okay, it's one can sit and calculate instead. Is it clear what I said until now?
Yeah. I think so. Yeah. No questions from our side.
No question. Okay, then
I just. There are only questions.
Okay, so to review how to do this, we should go back to 2004 when myself and John Cardi introduced this path integral approach to entanglement entropy that I'm sure most of you are familiar with, but I will just go quickly through it. And okay, you know that the density matrix at finite temperature is nothing but the path integral in which on the Euclidean action, so we work in Euclidean space-time, not Lorentz. You know better than me how to go back to Lorentz in case it's needed. And okay, so in Euclidean space-time, the reduced density matrix, the element of the reduced density matrix that written here is just the path integral in which you force the state at the boundary at imaginary time equals zero and beta to assume the value that that are the elements of the reduced density matrix. What the trace does in this game is to sew together edges, the two edges, to form a cylinder, and in fact you get the partition function is just the path integral on the cylinder. When you deal with the reduced density matrix, what you do is to sew only those points that X that belongs to the system of interest A and in B, sorry, and leave open cuts along A, which is the subsystem of interest, okay? As is represented pictorially in this last cylinder where there are the subsystem A is built with three disjoint subsystem, okay? Now, from this path integral, again, what one does reconstruct the entanglement entropy, which is minus trace rho A log rho A, as the limit for n that goes to one of the derivative with respect to n of trace of rho A to the n. And trace of rho A to the n is similar to what we discussed before, but in this case, the eigenvalues of the reduced density matrix are all positive and there are no issue with being even on dot, so which you can just work with arbitrary number n. And trace of rho to the n is nothing but the sewing together of in a cyclical way of n of the cylinder above, which in the limit of zero temperature become plane. So like trace of rho to the n is a Riemann surface like the one that is depicted in this slide in pink and white. I hope you can you understand this plot. This is trace of rho cube, which is three density matrix joined cyclically in such a way, and then that such a way that the last one is joined with the first one. Okay, and as you know, trace of rho A to the n are also related to this Rényi entanglement entropy, which are defined in the last line, but which I will not touch during this talk. I think you are all familiar with this construction. May I? It's true.
I think in Potsdam, yeah. If anyone online has a question, then they should ask it now. No questions from us.
No question. Okay, so let's continue. How you get information about this Riemann surface? I'm making this construction because we will use also later. So just if we make it now for an easy example, will be easier for the complicated case instead. If I would have just done in after, it would be too complicated. So what one does is to take this Riemann surface that is depicted as the plane W in this slide and map to the complex plane. How to make this mapping is quite easy. It's just an exercise of complex analysis. You first take the cut that is between two points U and V and map the branch cut between minus infinity and zero through the Möbius transformation that is W that goes in zeta equals W minus U divided W minus V that is in the first line of the slide, okay? And this transformation what does maps you to an n-sheeted Riemann surface which is a branch cut on the real negative axis, which means it's exactly the surface that you introduce in complex analysis to define the root of order n. So this Riemann surface is uniformized to the complex plane just by the root of order n. So you take just z equals zeta to the 1 over n, and you map the Riemann surface to the complex plane. So in total, you can take the original surface with branch point in U and V and map to the complex plane just by the transformation that is written on the at the end of the first line of this slide, that is W minus U divided W minus U to the power 1 over N. Okay? And this transformation so uniformized the Riemann surface into the into the plane. If you work out what are the consequences of mapping this transformation on the stress energy tensor, for example, you can get the explicit expectation value of trace of rho A to the n, which is what we are behind to. And okay, so trace of rho A to the n, which is equal to the partition function of this strange and sheeted Riemann surface, is nothing but u minus v to the power minus c over 6 n minus 1 over n, which is written on the right side of the slide itself. And if of this formula you take the replica limit as is written after the arrow, you get the famous result c over 3 log l, which was obtained many in the 94 by Olsen, Larsen, and Wilczek, that okay, nowadays everyone knows. And okay, you can obtain, as you see, very easily these results by just transforming the unsheeted Riemann surface to the plane. And one of the consequences of this approach is that trace of rho to the n is equivalent to the two-point function of twist field. Okay, as it's written in the slides, after trace of rho to the n equals the two-point function of this twist field Tn u and t bar n v, and this twist field have scaling dimension that is c over 12 n minus 1 over n, that is just a consequence of the value of trace of rho a to the n itself. Okay, so what the twist field do is to transform expectation value on the Riemann surface into expectation value on the complex plane, so that one don't automatically taking care of the non-trivial monodromy of the Riemann surface. Okay, this is really prehistory. Still, I want to mention that maybe it's not so much known to you that don't come from more condensed matter community, that these ideas of replica, etc., that was developed mainly by myself and John Cardi as a theory tool, okay, to get as a trick to calculate the entanglement entropy, actually has been realized in nowadays in cold atoms. There is this very nice experiment in the group of Markus Grein at Harvard, where they measure explicitly the entanglement entropy, but really constructed two replicas. Okay, so they cannot measure the entanglement entropy, they measure the second Rényi entropy, okay, by some complicated way of creating two identical systems and joining them in a particular way which coincide with our replicas. This is very interesting. And in fact, through this experiment, for some relatively small system, they are able to measure the entanglement entropy that, as you can see in this, okay, I don't want to discuss the experimental results, but they have some of the shape that we have seen in many theory calculation in our life. Okay, so these Rényi entropy nowadays are accessible to experiment exactly by exploiting the replica trick. But okay, I want to move on and move to what we are interested in, that is calculating trace distances in conformal field theory. Now, which trace distances we can access? We will access the trace distance between different excited states of conformal field theory. Okay, obviously of some subsystem. I will focus because it's much easier and because it's more instructive also, just on states that through the state operator correspondence correspond to primary operator. Okay, so I will concentrate on states of the conformal field theory which are obtained by the action on the vacuum of a primary field. Okay, and primary field are those fields that transform as written in this purple box. Okay, you are all expert of CFT, I don't think I should explain where this equation come from. Okay, they scale just locally as a global field will transform, basically. This is a primary field, and I will focus on state generated by primary operator. The density matrix of the entire density matrix a state generated by a primary operator have this form in Euclidean patintra that is written here, where you see, since you have a reduced a density matrix, you have both Brian and Cat, and you see the action of the operator and of its conjugate at plus and minus I infinity. Okay? This is all, I think you are all familiar with this construction. Okay? The system is finite, else the action of the primary operator will be washed out. Okay, so we have a finite system of length L. And so basically, let's take periodic boundary conditions. So we have an infinite cylinder, and in this infinite cylinder at plus or minus I infinity, we have the insertion of the operator in this conjugate in case it's not self-conjugate. Okay? So in the case there is not the operator insertion, taking the reduced density matrix and makes n copy of this guy will give the identity, so we insert the identity, which means the ground state, we will get the Riemann surface we just have studied. Okay, but if now we have an operator, what we will have? We will have n copies of this guy, okay? And in each copy, there are two operators at plus and minus I infinity, okay? Of this upsilon primary operator. Okay, this approach has been developed by Alcaraz, Berganza, and Sierra back in 2011. And so what they have shown is that the reduced density matrix corresponding to, in general, this actually is true for any operator, then when we can make easily the mapping for primary operator, but the reduced density matrix in the CFT of an excited state is just a qn point function of the operator that generates the state, okay? On the n-sheeted Riemann surface. Okay, is it clear this?
Yeah.
Okay, so this is what Alcaraz and Berganza have done long ago, and I will explain shortly how to deal with it. But okay, then for our case, and that's what has been done for the relative entropy, is that we don't need just trace of some power to the n, but we need trace of operator to given power, for example, for what you need for the relative entropy is trace of one operator to power one and the other operator to power n, okay? And obviously, repeating the game, what you get some two endpoint function where of different operator gamma one, this upsilon one and upsilon zero. Okay, and this has been worked out by Lashkari back in 2014. In our very specific case, we need trace of, let's say that we have an excited state made by two operator primary defined by this curly X and curly Y. We need the trace of object like trace of curly Y to the M, trace of curly X to the N. Actually, the order matters, but okay. All of them are basically the same. This will be the product of operator, will be the expectation value of Qn function of some Y and some X on the n-sheeted Riemann surface placed at plus and minus I infinity times some normalization factor as it's written in this big equation in the middle of the slide. I think you understand which equation I'm referring to, no? Hello?
Yes.
So it's clear this equation, this is our, the equation that we needed to calculate the trace distance, that is this trace of row zeros. Okay, the first equation in this slide here in CFT can be rewritten as each of that guys can be rewritten in this form here. Okay? Which is a Qn point function on an n-sheeted Riemann surface. How to deal this with this object? Okay, this is exactly what Alcaraz, Berganza, and Sierra did. There is nothing more complicated because okay, the only complicated thing is the combinatorics of the fields itself. But there are insertion of operators that now they are different. Before, for Rackard, Berganza, and Sierra, they were the same. And in fact, this last picture that you see here is stolen from their paper. Okay, so they, what they have is an N-sheeted Riemann surface where the operator are inserted in plus and minus I infinity. Okay, and in each surface they insert the same operator. Then with the first mapping, they map the that you see here, they map the branch cut between minus infinity and zero, exactly as we did. But by making this mapping, the two points that were at plus and minus I infinity go to finite values that are these two crosses red that are shown here. Okay? And then you have to uniformize this surface. And by uniformizing this surface, for example, for n equal to 3, you get a surface that is like that, where the various operator get inserted in this all these crosses. In this case, it's 6 crosses. And these crosses actually are at some very specific value of root of unities. Okay, just because if you follow these things, you see that the point at infinity go all on the unit circle. So this object should be at some root of unity that we know which one they are by following the map, the conformal map. And so the only difference between each term in our case and Alcaraz, Berganza, Sierra 1 is that the fields that appear at this red cross for specific n are not the same, but they are different. Okay, we have different fields inserted at this red cross. And we have to work out to follow the right combinatorics, the right fields where they are and what they bring, and then sum them up. Okay, but this is mainly technicality and there is really nothing deep after one understands what we have to do. Okay, and in fact, by following all this mapping, this is the final formula, okay, for the trace of rho x, y, curly x, curly y to the n. It's this complicated, it's sum of expectation value of products of this primary operator inserted at proper points that are of unit. Absolute value and the proper point fj fjl you can find here written on the in the slide and on the left down. Okay, you see where they are the definition, and this just comes from the conformal mapping. This what are fj and fjl are is just the map of infinity basically. Okay, you have to make this transformation here that is in the in this blue square, you map the points where at infinity where the operator are inserted. You have to map, you have to follow where they go, okay? And they go to this fj and fjl, okay? One goes to fj and the other one goes to fjl. And, okay, this is just a conformal map, this one. So you follow this transformation, you put all the right scale factors, you normalize things properly, and in the end, you get this complicated expression, okay? This complicated expression tells you that trace of rho x minus rho y to the n is the sum, a very complicated combinatoric sum of correlation function on the complex plane. Okay, so correlation function that we know since ages how to compute. In some cases, we know that in some cases they are too complicated, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, okay? But already from this very complicated expression, I think one important information can be read without making any calculation. That if you take the limit n that goes to one, independently if it's even or odd, you see that all the dependence on the cutoff epsilon that is just on the first line goes away because hn is this c over 24 n minus 1 over n, and for n that goes to one, this is zero. So there is no dependence on the cutoff. And the trace distance we are aiming to, so it's a scale invariant quantity and it's universal, okay? Because it doesn't depend on the cutoff. First of all, it's scale invariant in the sense that it depends only on the ratio of L, small l is the dimension of the subsystem and capital L is the dimension of the system, the length of the system, so the length of subsystem. And so it's just a function of the ratio between subsystem and system length. And there is no dependence on the cutoff. It's dimensionless, so it's scale invariant. And this is already non-trivial. The other...
Do you have some intuition about that? I mean, was it obvious from the...
No, it's not obvious. The other distances, if you take the two distance, the four distance, these are not scale invariant. They are scale covariant, obviously. They transform covariantly. If we are in a CFT, everything is should be scale covariant. This is scale invariant. No, I don't have... I didn't know a priori this. Maybe someone would have guessed, but okay. I don't feel like I have a very clear... very clear intuition that in one sentence I can say, yes, this should have been expected. I can cook up arguments by knowing the result, but that's not... this will be a posteriori prediction, so post-diction, not prediction. No, I don't have an easy argument why it should be the case, and I found very, very important in CFT that this object is... the trace distance is special in CFT, even because it's the only scale invariant distance. All the other, like the two distance, that's what you will calculate much easier and in one line calculation, which is related to relative entropy also. This object is not scale invariant. So, no, I don't have an easy way to tell why. And it's one of the things that still stay open, I think. Okay, so this without making calculation. Still, having general results from this formula is quite difficult because it's a generic correlation function of generic primary operator. Okay, they are not known, okay, in generically. What we can get, in fact, this explicit formula is too messy to get some ID continuation. But what we can do, we can get very general results for small subsystem size, exploiting the operator product expansion of twist operator, which was already worked out by myself, Cardi, and Tony back many years ago. And okay, using this OP, I don't re-explain the OP. Just applying straightforwardly to our case, we got an expression that is written here in the middle of the session of the slide. And the non-trivial entry from the OP is the OP amplitude B, K1, X1, X2, X2, Xn. Okay, this is the non-trivial entry, which can be calculated with the method that myself, Cardi, and Torni worked out in 2011. And, okay, of this complicated expression that is an exact representation now expansion of our distance of order n, the leading term in the OP is the one by the quasi-primary field, such as the difference in sigma and rho state is non-zero, just to not have a vanishing right-hand side. Okay, you see that in this right-hand side, there are always the expectation value of the field that enter in the channel of the OP, okay? If this field in that channel is zero, obviously there is no... the contribution of that field will be zero, and one should go to next order. Okay, so one should find the operator with the smallest dimension such that its expectation value in the state sigma and in the state rho is different. Okay, once this state is identified, in the case it's not degenerate, in the case it's degenerate also is doable, and we have done, but it's just again combinatorics, no physics. The distance in that case is dominated by that operator, so the distance scales like L to the power delta phi, where delta is the scaling dimension of this operator, times the difference of the expectation value of the field in the two state, okay, that we know, times this function x phi, which is the replica limit of the OP coefficient b. Basically, you should write the OP coefficient b phi 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 phi, and x phi is the replica limit of the OP coefficient with b with 2p phi, okay? Which whose explicit expression in terms of correlation function of the field phi on the complex plane is written as last equation in this slide, okay? Now you see that calculating this OP coefficient is in principle quite endable in almost any CFT. More difficult is to say if we are able to make the ID continuation. We will see that for free boson we can make in all the cases. Okay, this is the object we are dealing with. Is it clear what I mean in this slide?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay, so just for curiosity, there is an interesting bound that this x phi, which is the can be bound by the a maximum value that is reported in this orange box. And this inequality comes from an inequality between the distance and the relative entropy, which is called Pickler inequality. And okay, I was not aware of it before, but okay, I found it. We found this inequality, and this inequality leads a bound on the on this OP coefficient. By the way, I must say that the OP coefficient, in the cases that we have worked out, at least, is a much nicer expression than this X max, that is a square root of gamma function and something very complicated. Okay, time is going on. Let's see some very some real application of this. The main application we did was to the free bosonic theory. It's obvious why. And in the free bosonic theory, we just consider two primary operators, which are the vertex operator and the derivative operator that you all know and are written here. And for the vertex operator, that very general formula that is written in this slide here, when specified to the correlation function of vertex operator that you all know how to calculate, it's just in Coulomb-Gauss approach, it's just some product of signs that impact. They can be written, in fact, as it's in this green box. Okay, this green box is just a specialization of that correlation function to the vertex operator, where the single correlation for the single terms in the sum is written as this dn that is explicitly written as product of sign at the end of the slide, okay? And the power depends on this quantity delta alpha that is related to the dimension of the vertex operator, okay? I mean, this is just taking the known results for correlation function of vertex operator and putting inside the sum. Nothing more than that, okay? And you get this explicit sum that I write here, okay? So this is really plottable in Mathematica. If you have n equal 3, 4, 5, okay, 3 will get 0. If you get 2, 4, 6, 8, you can just plot this function in Mathematica. It's just give this equation to Mathematica, you can plot. So this is the final answer. Still, they are written in quite complicated way to get the analytic continuation. In general, it's difficult, in fact, to get the analytic continuation. One case in which we were able to get the analytic continuation is for delta alpha equal 1, which means for the vertex operator 1, 0, or 0, 1, or whatever n times that this combination here of alpha and alpha bars gives 1. In this case, this strange sum of products can be simplified magically in this very short product of sign. Okay, it's really magic that this happened. Not that I really understand all details, it just happened. Then with the more or less standard technique to make the analytic continuation, you can write this the sign that appear here as an integral over as the logarithm of the sign is the integral over some gamma function, and then you manipulate this expression. Okay, you can write explicitly the product, and you get to this final expectation value to this analytic continuation. Now, you see the first line is valid only for NE being an even number, okay? Else has no sense. Instead, the second line in this formula is the analytic continuation to all real number. Actually, all complex, not that we care about complex NE, but this expression is valid for any real number. So NE can be pi, can be 3.5, but can be even 1 and 3. In particular, for N equal 1, that's what interests us, the analytic continuation that gives the trace distance, this huge expression simplifies to a very trivial result, that is small L divided by capital L. Okay, which means that the first term in the OPE that we just calculated before saturate the entire trace distance in this very specific case. While this happens, I have no clue. Okay, so this is a magic. It's not something generic because for non, for other n, it's completely, it's a very complicated function. It's not a simple function. So the OPE is not saturated for generic n, only in the limit n that goes. Why it happens? Okay, it's a mystery to me. So this is the first analytic continuation that we master. The second analytic continuation that we master is the one of the OPE. Okay, so if you remember the formula that I wrote before for the OPE was these things in the green box. Here is the same just of before, where the complicated guy was this x phi that I report very small written here. In this case, we can work everything explicitly. And for the distance between vertex operators, for example, we get between two generic vertex operators, we get this formula for the OPE that is written here is the second equation of this slide, basically, while for the distance between vertex and current or vertex and derivative operator, we get the formula that is in the third line of the slides, okay? Which is just simple combination of alpha and alpha bar. One thing that is interesting of this equation is that if the vertex operator is the ground state, which means alpha and alpha bar are zero, the leading term between the current and the ground state is zero. Okay, so there is no, and one should go to the next order, which means it's the stress energy tensor, the following operator entering the channel, and this requires some special care. And the result in this case is given by the one in the next line, that the distance between the ground state and the current state J, which means the derivative operator, is this bit more complicated expression where xt can be exactly calculated 0.107 something. Okay, but the most important thing is that it doesn't start linearly in L but start with L squared. Okay, so because the OP operator that enter is the stress energy tensor, it has dimension q and not one like the current. Okay? And okay, a byproduct of this calculation is actually the distance between the current state and the stress energy tensor, which is JJ bar. And okay, we just, since it was a byproduct of this calculation, we calculated it is just the same. Okay, but now I want to show how this thing agree with some numerical data. I will be very fast, I'm close to the end. So we made some calculation for the XX spin chain whose continuum limit is a free compact boson with a given compactification radius. So it's just what we have done until now. And okay, so you see like in this first plot, the blue card is the distance between the ground state and the vertex 1, 0. So the distance, the one that is exactly linear, and we see the fact that it's exactly linear. With the other vertex operator, we see that numerical calculation that are the yellow, the green, and the red are not linear. They have a non-trivial form. We are not able to calculate the analytic continuation in these cases, but we can get the small interval expansion, and this perfectly agree with our calculation of the small length expansion. The same is true for all other plots that I'm not going to show because our time is really going expired already. So what I want to say is that what we can get also are the other norms, not only the trace distance, but norms like in these plots I report norm 2, 3, and 4, and we can see that in these cases, norm 2, 3, and 4 agree very well with our prediction in all cases, and we are very happy about that, okay? Noting, I will just quickly stop by saying that there are many results that I didn't mention here, like more tests in XX chain, okay? Many tests for the free fermion. So all the results for the free fermion plus that have been tested against results with the critical Ising chain. And then we applied these ideas to relative entropy and fidelities. And okay, really, I didn't, I imagine that I didn't have the time to talk about them, so I didn't include in this talk. I want to conclude just by saying a few words. So what we did is to develop a systematic method to calculate the trace distance in quantum field theory. And we use just to calculate distances between state in conformal field theory. And these I already found extremely informative. But there are many future directions. First of all, one can have more general application to two-dimensional conformal field theory, like what happens if we include the temperature or inhomogeneities into our game, what is the distance between a finite temperature state and a zero temperature state, etc., all these kind of questions. But one can generalize to more complicated circumstances, like what happened to massive quantum field theory, also to understand quantum phase transition, if these distances have some meaning for quantum phase transition, what happened for higher dimension, and the things that on which we are currently work on is the application out of equilibrium. That was my initial motivation, actually, so to understand if this trace distance can have some meaning on thermization against state thermization hypothesis and all kinds of things. So I will conclude here and just leave time to question if you have. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Anyone have any final questions? Anyone online has a question? Now is your chance.
So to what extent these calculations are feasible in higher number of dimensions?
No. Okay, for higher dimension, the equation, the only equation that applies to higher dimension is the first one, that we can use the replica trick.
Yeah, that's my point.
But still, I will, there are some computations that are possible in higher dimension, okay, like for free boson, for some very specific bipartition, like the sphere or the, okay. I would be curious to see if we can say something in that case. I don't think it's an impossible calculation, actually. Just that for the present case, after having the idea of using the replica trick, that is here, okay? This last line in this slide, the old technology to calculate this trace of powers, etc., was already developed in the two-dimensional case. But I, for some, not any very much generality, I think that can exist higher dimensional example where this can be done, but okay, not so generically, not so nicely, but some specific cases can be done, and okay, there are many people working in higher dimension, and probably it's worth to have a look.
No other questions? Okay. So in that case, let's thank Pascal again.
Okay, thank you.